In this reaction, we're going to look to see what it means to be a spontaneous reaction. We're going to define free energy and see how we can predict the spontaneity of a reaction based on the enthalpy and entropy changes at various temperatures. So free energy, symbolized by delta G, is about the amount of energy that's actually available to do work. And it's actually a balance between the randomness or disorder of entropy and the heat of a reaction, or the enthalpy. When scientists first began to look at spontaneity, they first tried to look at just entropy or just enthalpy, and what they found was that neither entropy nor enthalpy were a good predictor of spontaneity of reaction. And so they came up with a new term with free energy that combines both elements of entropy and enthalpy for this new value, delta G, which is known as free energy, that is able to predict the spontaneity of a reaction. So with free energy, or that energy available to do work, we have a balance between entropy and enthalpy. And the sign of that free energy measurement will allow us to determine whether or not a reaction is spontaneous or non-spontaneous. So when delta G is less than zero, so a negative value, it is a spontaneous reaction. When delta G is greater than zero, it is a non-spontaneous reaction. So by knowing the sign convention, we can determine whether a reaction will be spontaneous or not. So when we look at the formula for our Gibbs free energy, what we see is delta G, and remember delta means a state function, so it only depends on the initial and final states, equals delta H, which is our change in enthalpy, minus T delta S. Now, as I said, we're only going to look at this qualitatively, which means we're just going to look at the relative values that determine whether or not a reaction is spontaneous or not. So let's first look at the situation where delta H is positive and delta S is negative. If that's the case, then when delta S is negative, the last part of this equation, the minus T delta S, will be positive. So we have a delta H term that's positive, and we have a minus T delta S term that is positive. Therefore, the delta G value will also be positive. And if delta G is positive, then we know we have a non-spontaneous reaction. Now, if I look at delta H as negative and delta S is positive, making my minus T delta S term negative, I have two negative terms that together give me a negative delta G value, indicating that my reaction is spontaneous. Now, in those cases, it's either always non-spontaneous or always spontaneous. For the last two options, when both delta H and S are negative or both positive, we see it's going to depend on the temperature, because what we don't know is the magnitude of these two terms. So when I look at when delta H is negative, I see that, and delta S is negative, I see my minus T delta S term is positive. So it will depend on whether the delta H term is bigger or the T delta S term is bigger to determine whether delta G is negative or positive. We don't have to worry about whether what is considered a low temp versus a high temp. That will vary greatly from reaction to reaction. And so we only worry about if we say, well, it is a lower temp. So at a lower temperature, our minus T delta S term is smaller in magnitude than our delta H term. So as a result, we're going to get a negative delta G at low temperatures, indicating a spontaneous reaction. Now, if we're at high temperatures, what we see is our minus T delta S term is positive. And at a high temperature, when I plug my temperature value in, this number, this term, gets much, much larger, meaning the minus T delta S term is larger than the delta H term. Therefore, it's going to be a non-spontaneous reaction because delta G will be positive. We see something similar when we look at the values that are both positive for delta H and delta S. Our negative T delta S term is going to determine whether or not the delta H and T delta S combined is going to lead to a positive or negative delta G value. In this case, at low temperatures, we see that this term, the minus T delta S term, is smaller in magnitude than the delta H term. Because if we have a low temperature, T delta S will be small, and so we'll get a small minus T delta S. We will have a larger delta H, leading to a positive delta G and a non-spontaneous reaction. For a high temperature, we see that our minus T delta S term predominates, and as a result, the magnitude of the minus T delta S term is greater than the magnitude of the enthalpy, and as a result, we get a negative delta G value and a spontaneous reaction. So what we've been looking at is dealing with spontaneity, whether a reaction happens on its own or not. And that's what Gibbs free energy tells us about whether something is what we say thermodynamically favorable. Will it happen on its own? What we're going to look at next is looking at kinetics and the rate of a reaction. We all heard the commercial from jewelers saying diamonds are forever. Well, technically, they're not. Because diamonds, over time, actually go from the diamond form of carbon, which is worth a lot of money, to the graphite form of carbon, which is essentially worth nothing. And so what we see is that this process does happen spontaneously, that it is thermodynamically favorable. However, it takes a really, 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 really long time. And so as a result, when they say diamonds are forever, they truly aren't, but even if you had your great 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 grandmother's diamond ring, you would notice very little difference in the diamond than when she saw it when she first received it. So what you're looking at is that spontaneity and speed are not related. These are two separate issues. We can have reactions that are spontaneous, which are very fast, or we can have reactions that are spontaneous and very slow.